we were mortgaged to the Yanks.
It's 2007. You and I can justifiably walk with a new spring in our step. Why? Because at the very end of 2006, Britain finally paid off its debt to the United States of America from the end of the Second World War. Now, I must admit that though I was lucky enough to be Britain's ambassador for more than 5 years in Washington, I had no idea that we were still mortgaged to the Americans. Throughout this period, I witnessed extraordinary events. The failed impeachment of Bill Clinton, horrors of 9/11, and, of course, the run-up to the war in Iraq.
Really, a week went by without someone invoking the special relationship. It's a phrase I banned my staff from using because it led us to expect too much and comprehend too little about the British-American relationship.
I wish I had known more about the loan back then. It proves my point. It's a cautionary tale about rhetoric and reality.
Victory in Japan Day, the 15th of August, 1945. All along Whitehall, mandarins and munition workers, diplomats and dockers linked arms together to celebrate the end of World War II. These were the men and women who had emerged victorious from 6 years of devastating total war. And they had just elected a Labour government, a government that had promised them a new Jerusalem. But what they didn't know is that Britain was bankrupt. And our closest and richest wartime ally, the United States of America, had chosen this very day, VJ Day, to pull the plug on bankrolling Britain's war effort. After all, went the reasoning in Washington, the war is over. Few Britons that day would have realized that all they had fought for and voted for hung in the balance.
And that's when our American friends cut off the cash. It was time for one of those emergency Whitehall meetings. I've been to a few. You can almost cut the atmosphere of crisis with a knife. There's no time, of course, for a full cabinet meeting. All the Prime Minister wants is the key ministers and officials that really matter.
At that meeting, the buck stopped with a man scarcely a month into his job.
The election that resulted in a stunning surprise. The Churchill government overturned by a landslide. New Prime Minister, Labour Party leader Clement Attlee.
Our American allies found it almost inconceivable that the British had turned against their wartime commander-in-chief, Churchill. But in fact, many servicemen, like RAF pilot Tony Benn, had been Labour's most active campaigners in the run-up to Election Day.
That was a very dramatic day, and it was always so exciting. I was young, of course, but it was more than that. It was a whole new era opening up.
Dennis Healey, then a major in the Royal Engineers, stood as a candidate for Attlee's Labour Party.
The most important thing is they wanted what they called a better Britain. Could still remember, it was only 20 or so years earlier, after the First World War, how the hopes had been betrayed, and they were determined this shouldn't happen this time.
Back at the crisis session in Whitehall, everyone looked to one man for the solution for bankrupt Britain.
The man with the plan?
John Maynard Keynes, Lord Keynes, the government's top economic guru and the most controversial and famous economist in the world.
He warned that Britain faced nothing less than a financial Dunkirk.
What does one mean by a financial Dunkirk? Great loss of prestige? An acceptance of the position of a second-class power, rather like France? At home, a greater degree of austerity would be necessary than we have experienced at any time during the war.
Ministers must have loved that. And then Keynes left his most devastating blow until last. There would have to be, he said, an indefinite postponement of the realization of the best hopes of the new government.
This leaflet is coming through your letterbox one day soon, or maybe you have already had your copy. Read it carefully.
The new government had promised war-weary Britons a cradle-to-grave welfare state.
The minister sees a model of the centre, which brings under one roof child welfare, dental and natal clinics, besides local health services.
As well as the new NHS, they'd get state-owned industries, education for all, and no more unemployment. In short, they'd voted for a brave new Britain.
The answer is that the socialist appeal is essentially a moral one.
It was about a new world. People said to each other, in the 30s there was mass unemployment, the means test, fascism, rearmament, but there's no unemployment in wartime. If you can have full employment by killing Germans, why can't you have full employment by building hospitals, building schools, recruiting teachers? And that's how the welfare state was born. People said, we plan for war, we've got to plan for peace.
Let's go forward into this fight in the spirit of William Blake. I will not cease from mental fight, nor shall the sword sleep in my hand, till we have built Jerusalem in England's green and pleasant land.
But in August 1945, addressing the crisis meeting, Keynes told ministers they couldn't fund bread and water, never mind the milk and honey of Jerusalem.
As an experienced Whitehall operator, Keynes didn't exactly tell ministers what to do. In true civil service fashion, he offered them options from which they could choose. One, starvation. Two, temptation. Three, justice.
Get no new funds in, and starvation, option one, was inevitable. Choose temptation, and we'd try to take out a normal loan on commercial terms, despite our inability to pay it back.
Justice, the very name tells us Keynes's preference, was to ask the Americans, the only country with the cash to bail out bankrupt Britain, for a multi-billion dollar grant. Keynes reasoned that Britain had carried the burden of fighting fascism until the Americans finally entered the war late. Keynes, who was not best known in Whitehall for his modesty, told ministers that he could deliver option three, justice, in the shape of an American $5 billion grant. That's about $54 billion in today's money.
So why did he think that? The answer lies not in Keynes's experiences of the Second World War, but in his intense convictions born of the dark days of World War I and its aftermath. It was to Charleston, this farmhouse in Sussex, that Keynes sought refuge during these tumultuous years. Here, the old Etonian, Cambridge don, and city millionaire mixed with conscientious objectors, sexual freethinkers, and political radicals. And here he developed his own approach to economics as a powerful tool for social change.
Keynes was a member of the Bloomsbury set, that group of bohemian artists and writers who were as famous for their bed hopping as they were for the work that they did here in Charleston. Before marrying the Russian ballerina, Lydia Lapakova, Keynes had had a long relationship with the painter Duncan Grant. And it was Grant that did this wonderful portrait of Keynes in 1917.
2 years later, Keynes travelled to France after the First World War. At Versailles, he helped the British delegation negotiate the peace treaty. But, horrified by the vindictive nature of its terms, he resigned. And putting pen to paper in the sanctuary of Charleston, he explained why.
In the pages of this short book, The Economic Consequences of the Peace, Keynes railed against the punitive reparations imposed on Germany. Destroying the German economy, he thought, would lead to enduring bitterness and further devastating war in Europe. If we take the view, wrote Keynes, that Germany must be kept impoverished and her children starved, vengeance, I dare predict, will not limp. The book was a bestseller, and tragically, Keynes proved correct.
Chasing rainbows, waiting to find a little bluebird.
It's always seemed pretty odd to me that seasoned politicians and an intellectual giant like Keynes could have been seduced by the notion that the Americans would simply hand over billions of dollars, as it were, no questions asked. I think the clue to this lies in the name that Keynes gave to his plan, justice. For him, it was a question of morality. In his view, the Americans had been Johnny-come-latelys in the war. During the dark days of 1940 and the hideous nights of the Blitz, Britain had stood alone. As Churchill put it, the courage and sacrifices of our finest hour were made not just for ourselves, but to save the whole world.
If we fail, then the whole world, including the United States, including all that we have known and cared for, will sink into the abyss of a new dark age.
The national feeling was that, just like St. Paul's Cathedral, heroically, defiantly, miraculously withstanding the nightly raids of the Luftwaffe, we as a great nation had survived the worst to protect, to safeguard the best hopes of mankind. America's moral debt to us was immense, so the thinking went. The United States had eventually stood shoulder to shoulder with us. So how could they storm ahead now, leaving us bereft, exhausted, and broke?
And broke we truly were. Between 1939 and 41, we'd liquidated overseas holdings, sacrificed most of our export trade, and borrowed to the hilt. So by 1945, the national debt had tripled. Our external borrowings were the highest in our history, more than £128 billion in today's money.
Not for the first time, nor for the last,
there was a gulf of misunderstanding between the two sides of the Atlantic. Many Americans felt that twice in one century they had ridden to the rescue of Europe at great cost and at great